This is Colin Gomel. In this demonstration, we'll extend the previous database of students to add some additional functionality. Let's execute structs2.cpp. So we'll compile and run this application. And let's start by adding a new entry. So let's add a person whose name is Colin Gomel, say. If we I've added a new field to the table, in this case, to the array. Let's say Colin Gomel has a score of 50. And so let's print all entries. You'll see that record number 0, the record whose index is 0, the name is Gomel Colin, and the score is 50. Okay, let's add another item. Let's add Smith, say. Let's add Jerry Smith. And let's say Jerry Smith gets a score of 60. So now, as before, you'll see that Colin Gomel has a score of 0, and Jerry Smith has Colin Gomel has an index of 0, score of 50. Jerry Smith has an index of 1 and score of 60. Now we'll make one more change here. Let's add a third person. Let's add Annie Arnold. And let's say that Annie has a score of 80. So now you'll notice that Annie Arnold has been sorted into alphabetical order. Notice that Gomel, that used to be in position 0, has been moved up to position number 1. Smith, who used to be in position 2, has been moved, excuse me, who used to be in position 1, has been moved up to position 2. And we have inserted Annie Arnold at position 0 in the table. So that in this case, the thing that's different is we're maintaining the order sorted in alphabetical order by name. Let's add another element to this. Let's assume Annie has a brother, Archie. So we'll let's say here's Archie, and the last name is Arnold, and Archie scored 25. So again, at this point, we have an Annie Arnold and an Archie Arnold. They've both been inserted into the table, into the correct positions, 0 and 1. Colin Gomel has been moved up one more into index position 2. Jerry Smith has also been moved up one more into index position 3. Okay, now I've also added some search capability to the database. So let's see if we can find everybody whose name begins, say, A-R-N. Sure enough, we notice that there are two A-R-Ns in the database, Annie Arnold in position 0 and Archie Arnold in position 1. So finally, I've provided a capability to delete an entry. If Archie Arnold is no longer part of the department, for example, let's enter D here to delete an entry. The number of the student that we want to delete is the student in position number 1, index position number 1. I'll delete that student. Now if I print the table, you'll see that Annie Arnold is in position 2, but Colin Gomel has moved back down to position number 1, and Jerry Smith has moved back down into position number 2. So when we take a row out of the middle of the table, we have to move all the subsequent rows back down by one position. And in a moment, I'll show you where to find the code that does that. Right now, we'll quit the application, and let's look at the code. Okay, so as before, I've arbitrarily set the maximum array size to be 100, nothing different there. I've added another field into the definition of the person struct, so a person object now has a first name, a last name, and a score. Notice, by the way, the semicolon that always ends the struct definition. That confuses most people. In general, curly braces don't have semicolons at the end of them, but a struct is a quite odd exception, actually, for various technical reasons that I won't get into. But there's at the end of the struct definition, that curly brace has a semicolon. Now, in this demonstration, I've also not used global variables. So the student's array has been declared inside main. And because add student, print students, and the other functions need access to the student array, I've had to pass that array as a parameter to those functions. So this time in the function prototype for add student, print students, find students, and delete students, you'll notice they all have two parameters. The first parameter is the array of students that they're to operate on. And the second parameter is the number is essentially the number of elements that have been allocated in that array. That's the same thing, it turns out, as the current index. If the current index, for example, is 6, that means the next person to be added would go into position 6. That means that there are that means that the last position that's been occupied in the array is position number 5. Okay, so in this case, in the function main, we have an array of students of the designated size. The current index starts out at 0 as before, because when we start the program up, there are no students in the database. We have a very similar menu structure. I'm reading a line at a time this time, by the way, instead of just a string at a time. So this time, the user can type whole lines with spaces in them. It will make the program a little more robust. If the user types nothing in the line, in order to stop the menu program crashing, I've set menu selection to just a period, which will cause the case selection here to hit the default, which means it will be an invalid selection. So this is another example of a switch statement that looks at the first letter the user types. In this case, the user can type a line as long as they want. But the coding here will look at the first letter, and if it's an A, we'll add a student. If it's an F, we'll search for students, and so on. Otherwise, the code here is pretty similar to the code last time. As I said, I made it slightly more robust so that it shouldn't crash. It should be more bulletproof in the face of the user typing invalid entries. Okay, so adding a student. The add student function needs to know which array to add the student to. So I have passed the student's array here as a parameter to the function. The student's array is an array of type person, and remember that arrays are always passed in C++ by reference. That means that if I change the array inside the add student function, the array that was declared inside the main function is automatically updated at the same time. It's implicitly updated because the array was passed by reference. Of course, if I add a student, that's also going to change the value of the current index. In fact, it's going to add one to it. So I need to increment the current index by one. It's really important, therefore, that I pass current index by reference, because otherwise I'll simply be incrementing a local copy of current index inside the add student function. And what I need to do is change the current index, the real current index that's been declared up here inside the main function, this one declared right here. So if I have a variable declared inside main and I need to change its value inside some other function, which I do here when I add a student, I must pass that variable by reference, or the original variable will not get updated. That's the reason for the ampersand. That ampersand, int ampersand current index, passes the parameter current index by reference, and in this case, it's crucially important. Okay, the code for add student is quite simple, similar to last time. First of all, we make sure that there's room in the array to hold the new student. Then we enter the data for the new student. We read in the first name, we read in the last name into an object called entry, which is of type person here. The score is slightly different. I read the string into a variable called input, and then I convert that string, the function a to I converts ASCII to integer, and it converts the string up to be of type integer so that I can put it in the score attribute of the person object called entry. Okay, so the next thing that I have to do is find out where this entry should be inserted in the table. remember that I'm going to insert the entry in alphabetical order by last name. And that implicitly means that possibly lots of entries have to move up in the table to create the slot into which to add the new item. I'm not going to go into the details of the algorithm here, but the code that does that is really right here. The first thing that we do is find the right place for where the entry should fit in the table. And having done that, this loop here moves every subsequent item up by one position. So we move everything up by one position, and then we take the current entry and we copy it into the ith position of the student's table. We increment current index by one, and we've added the entry to the database. The code at the bottom here, by the way, is what happens if the entry that we're adding happens to belong at the end of the table. So if we search the whole table, we still haven't found the right position to insert the new entry. Then the entry goes at the end of the table, and this is the code that causes that to happen right here, those three lines there. Okay, print students is essentially the same algorithm as before. We go through the table and display the first name and the last name and the student score. And find students is an ability whereby we ask somebody to enter some text, the last name, and what we do is we search for all students in the database whose last name begins with the characters that the user enters. So if you just enter an A, for example, we'll find all students whose last name begins with the letter A. The algorithm for doing that is quite simple. It's a sequential search through the table. We start at the beginning and we go until we get to the end of the records in the table, marked by current index. And what we do for each element in the table, for each row in the table, we take the ith row in the table, we take the last name attribute, and using the find method is one of the things we can do with strings in C++, we try and find the key that the user entered. And if the key is found at position 0, the return value of the find method returns the location in the string where the key was found, assuming that it was indeed found. So if the key is found at position number 0, then the ith student in our table matches the key that the user entered and will display that student as being a match for the search. Many students can match, of course, for the search. If I search on A, I'm going to find all students whose name begins with an A. And this loop here will print out all of the students for whom the key A was found at position 0 of the last name. Now, deleting a student is very similar to adding a student. We enter the number of the student that we have to delete. We make sure that it's a valid number. It has to be greater than or equal to 0, and it has to be less than the current index. It has to be a current row in the table. But what we have to do is move every item in the table down one to delete the student that's in the ith position. And again, I won't go through the details of the code, but that's what this code here does. It moves every entry. In other words, if I'm trying to delete student in position number 5, I have to move student 6 into 5, I have to move 7 into 6, I have to move 8 into 7, and so forth. So I have to move all the students down in the right order to fill up the gap that's created when I delete a student that's in the middle. And if you look carefully at what this does, that's what this little loop here does. It moves everything down by one position. Okay, thank you very much.